In my commentary, I would like to suggest that the harms done to non-human animals, which we normally describe as speciesist, are often, if not most of the time, instances of ableism applied to non-human sentient beings. Furthermore, I would like to briefly explore the possibility that the framework of intersectionality developed in feminist studies is helpful to understand the particular way in which non-human animals escape the standard rhetorical strategies we otherwise use to protect the members of each of the two marginalized groups they are included in, that is the non-humans and the cognitively limited beings. So I won't be commenting directly the two great presentations Shelley and Agnes just gave. This was Matthew's job, but I will mostly aim at transiting towards the general discussion that we want to have with you all about the connection between speciesism and ableism. We generally take anti-speciesists to believe that we are not justified in attributing less moral importance or value to the individuals who belong to certain animal species, or less consideration to their interests than to the similar interests of the members of other species. Anti-speciesists oppose a moral discrimination based on species membership. The editor of the French journal Cahiers Antispécistes give speciesism the following definition, and I quote, "Speciesism is to species what racism and sexism are to race and sex respectively, the will to disregard or to take less into account the interest of some for the benefit of others, using as a pretext differences that are real or imaginary, but always devoid of any logical link with what they're supposed to justify," end of quote. This is a general definition, but different types of speciesism have been distinguished in the literature. Some people hold the view that human beings have a special moral value, a special dignity and rights simply by virtue of belonging to the human species, whatever we think that could mean after listening to Shelley. This is more or less the idea behind the theory of fundamental individual rights, at least according to what is stated in the preamble of our charters and declarations of human rights. The very fact of being part of humanity seems to give individuals a higher moral status, or again, a particular dignity, which is considered as grounding equal status as well as moral and legal basic rights. This type of belief that belonging to one species or another is sufficient to morally justify discrimination in the attribution of moral status is sometimes called, following James Rachel's terminology, pure speciesism. Pure speciesism consists in discriminating according to the species in which individuals are categorized. The species as such is seen as the criterion according to which the moral value of individual or the degree of consideration that should be given to their similar interest is determined. In denouncing pure speciesism, anti-speciesists point out that in the contemporary and secularized world we are now in, and where we no longer think that there's a natural order of things placing humanity at the top of a hierarchy of beings or a God who created man in his own image, belonging to one species or another is as such a strictly biological characteristic, which like one's skin colors or one's sex has no moral relevance in itself. Indeed, even if we think that the categorization of the living individual by species makes sense in biology and isn't largely motivated by political consideration, it shouldn't have any normative effect. And this is seldom disputed, even by those who defend speciesism. Those who seek to justify giving priority to human beings over other animals do not usually invoke the membership in the species Homo sapiens to do so, but some other attributes of the individuals belonging to this taxonomic group. As François and Agnès explained, they take humanness to refer to some capacities possessed in various degree and sometimes not possessed at all by all those who are biologically considered humans. This has led those who oppose discrimination against non-human animals to distinguish pure speciesism from a type of speciesism that can be called qualified speciesism. Qualified speciesism, which again is the most common form of speciesism, consists in giving more or less moral importance not to species as such, but to certain attributes typically associated with species. It is to these characteristics that the moral relevance is given. And the differential treatment of the members of different species is motivated and can be explained by the fact that they possess or not the attributes in question, or that they possess them more or less. Nowadays, the attributes invoked in support of human supremacy are most often some sort of cognitive abilities which we associate with humanity. And when speciesists morally rank the various non-human species among themselves, which can also be a form of speciesism, as Christine mentioned yesterday, they too often justify it by invoking not species membership as such, but characteristics typically associated with species. They will argue, for example, that dolphins, primates, and elephants have more moral value than chickens and fish because the former are more intelligent, have better memory, or are capable of more empathy than the latter. But then one might wonder whether it would not be better to speak of ableism in all those cases rather than speciesism. After all, the discrimination seems to be ultimately based not on species, but on mental capacities. Some authors prefer to avoid speaking of speciesism when the criterion on the basis of which the discrimination is made is not species itself, but a mere attribute of it. Indeed, why talk of qualified speciesism if species is in fact a mere proxy or a marker, as François used the term, facilitating the identification of individuals endowed or not with sophisticated cognitive abilities? If these capacities are what is considered morally significant, it would arguably be better if the way of speaking about the discrimination more exactly reflected that. We should speak of ableism, or even more precisely, perhaps, of rationalism, mentalism, or logocentrism, rather than speciesism. Prejudices and other discriminatory behaviors toward non-human animals should perhaps be thought of not as instances of speciesism, but rather as instances of ableism. And because rational autonomy, moral agency, self-consciousness, the possession of a symbolic language, and so forth have no relevance to moral status, it could be argued that activists who defend animals' interests instead of focusing on speciesism should be fighting ableism, as this is the type of injustice sentient non-human animals suffer from the most. That said, not all beings who lack sophisticated cognitive abilities are equally discriminated against. Human beings who do not meet the criteria for personhood, understood in the very narrow and problematic sense that many philosophers have given to the term, enjoy at least some basic individual rights that are still denied to non-human animals. Even if many humans are terribly marginalized in our society and suffer the damaging effects of our individual and systemic ableism, let's remember that even the common conceptions of discrimination and oppression in human affairs, as presented yesterday by Benjamin and Natalie, respectively, do not easily apply to neuroatypical human beings. All Homo sapiens are today, and rightly so, protected against being killed for food or leather, or rendered sick with serious diseases to study the effect of certain drugs. When the victims are not human, the consequences of ableism are of a particularly great violence. Without minimizing the seriousness of the injustices suffered by human disabled individuals in our societies, it seems, as François mentioned, that not belonging to the human species does make a significant difference. And this is probably what brings many anti-speciesists to conclude that animals still, and perhaps more fundamentally, suffer from an authentic form of speciesism. The mere fact that individuals are not human seems to make things much worse for them. Should we therefore conclude that anti-speciesists are right to talk about qualified speciesism in the end? Is the discrimination they oppose to ultimately based on species and only rationalized or justified, perhaps retrospectively, by referring to the cognitive inferiority of the members of the non-human species? Might be the case. After all, what truly or mainly motivates those who discriminate non-human beings is hard to discover without having access to what is going on in their head. On the other hand, this gap between our treatment of non-humans and our treatment of cognitively impaired, or following Amundsen's and Shelley's recommendation, cognitively different humans, could be explained by other factors. As ableists, we could still prefer, for one reason or another, to make a sort of exception for human beings who do not possess sophisticated cognitive capacities and prefer to treat them almost as if they did, pretending to consider them as moral equals to neurotypical human beings. There are many hypotheses offered in the literature to explain how we could be deeply ableist, but still act as if we believed in human moral equality. It could be to spare the sensitivity of the so-considered normal people who are emotionally attached to disabled individuals, for instance. It could be from a contractualist perspective, simply to ensure the stability of the society. could also be because we fear the slippery slope that could lead us to treat unfairly some individuals who are in fact persons, even though they don't appear to be. We should minimally acknowledge that the argument, unfortunately known as the argument from marginal cases, doesn't necessarily prove the prevalence of a form of qualified speciesism that isn't reducible to ableism. Animal advocates might still be going astray in concentrating their criticism on speciesism when, in fact, the discrimination suffered by non-human animals might be more accurately understood as an expression of ableism. Unless we do not have to choose between speciesism and ableism, would it really be better to avoid talking about speciesist instances of ableism or about ableist forms of speciesism when the discrimination is based on cognitive capacities but is directed at the members of other than human animal species, or when it particularly affects or harms non-humans? After all, and as Oscar Horta explains, discrimination against women or non-Caucasian is not always based on whether or not individuals have a uterus or are of European descent, but has also been justified on the grounds that they lack certain intellectual, moral, relational, or cultural characteristics. All of these instances of discrimination could not be equated with sexism or racism if those notions were reduced to their pure forms, as one might be tempted to do with speciesism. Do we really have to pick one and only one ism? It seems possible, at least for those who accept the concept of indirect discrimination, that women who are unjustly discriminated against on the basis of their age suffer from both sexism and ageism, that children or elders who are discriminated against on the basis of their being less physically powerful than middle-aged able-bodied adults suffered both ageism and ableism, that non-human animals who are considered as less intelligent than many humans and treated as morally inferior to us are victims of both ableism and speciesism. I think I even heard Lauren talk about those Homo sapiens who are dehumanized as victims of speciesism, which is also something Agnes said. And this might not preclude the possibility that in each case, one of the two terms offers a more accurate or adequate account of what is really going on than the other. It is also possible, as the theory of intersectionality allows to envisage, that the various types of discrimination do not simply describe the same phenomenon from different angles or add up in some cases to make individual victims of more instances of discrimination, but combine and interact in a way that reinforce one another and lead us to a greater and particularly vicious or at least invisibilized type of harm for the victims. Thinking about it, I come to believe that the theoretical framework of intersectionality may offer a good way to think about the situation of other animals. Non-human animals find themselves at the intersection of two marginalized groups, beings who don't belong to the human species, and as Christiane and Dalila mentioned, evoke alterity or otherness, and beings who are not endowed with the sophisticated cognitive ability that are so highly valued in our society. And in their case, it is as if these two motives for discrimination don't simply accumulate, but reinforce each other and prevent animals from benefiting from the rationales that could otherwise lead us to better defend them. We say on the one hand that strictly biological characteristics such as skin color, sex, or taxonomic group membership are morally irrelevant. Okay, maybe, but individuals who do not belong to our species are not as intelligent. So we're right in that to not treat them as we treat humans or as we would treat a super intelligent non-humans like E.T. or Superman, for instance. We also say, on the other hand, that cognitive capacities are not what counts, reminding ourselves that the more intelligent among humans do not have a higher moral status or more fundamental rights than those who are less intelligent. Okay, but animals are not humans, for goodness sake. Non-human animals are victims of both anthropocentric speciesism and ableism. And I'm wondering if these two sources of discrimination together make animals particularly vulnerable, if it ensures that they always lose out. If what animal egalitarians are opposed to is the fate of sentient beings more particularly, because sentient beings are capable of conscious, negative, and positive experiences, because they have a subjective perspective on things, and because they care about what happens to them and have interest, they should perhaps focus less on the problem of speciesism per se, and more on the moral relevance of the criterion of sentience. They should defend an egalitarian version of sentientism head on. affirming the fundamental moral equality of all sentient beings, leaving other comparisons aside, and offering the necessary space for a non-hierarchical view of individual differences. That would certainly benefit all sentient beings, humans and non-humans, who see their moral worth depending on morally irrelevant characteristics, and who seriously suffer from the many insidious and less insidious forms of discrimination and what Luc called the affordances based on those arbitrary criteria. Before opening the discussion to the audience, I'll simply conclude in saying that even though I question the conceptual usefulness of the notion of speciesism, I do recognize the political force it has already acquired, and therefore do not want to suggest that animal advocates could do without the notion without losing anything at all. Now that the concept is there and commonly used, I believe that we are justified in keeping it and even promoting it. My commentary aimed much more modestly at interrogating the discriminatory effects of our rampant ableism on other animals, hoping perhaps to counter this unfortunate wedge between animal rights and disabled rights advocates, in reminding anti-speciesists that what they are probably mainly concerned with is ableism. Thank you very much.